Yeah, waiting for Gina. She's sitting right back there talking to Rodney. So Gina's gonna play through while we read the song.
Okay.
And then we'll just start right in.
No.
No, 10,000 reasons. Morning. Lovely winter day, isn't it? It's great to be here, great to share this time together. As we begin, we're going to read this psalm, Psalm 103. It says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord executes righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in mercy. He will not always strive with us, nor will he keep his anger forever. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor punished us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. For he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. As for man, his days are like grass. As a flower of the field, so he flourishes. For the wind passes over it, and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children, to such as keep his covenant, to those who remember his commandments to do them. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. Bless the Lord, you his angels, who excel in strength, who do his word, heeding the voice of his word. Bless the Lord, all you his hosts, you ministers of his, who do his pleasure. Bless the Lord, all his works, in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul." Let's stand together and let's sing this out. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Sign.
the Lord, O my soul. Let's read a psalm as we continue here. Psalm number 47. Psalm and song are interchangeable words because a psalm is simply a Hebrew song. So let's repeat this together. Oh, clap your hands, all you peoples. Shout to God with the voice of triumph. For the Lord Most High is awesome. He is a great king over all the earth. He will subdue the peoples under us and the nations under our feet. He will choose our inheritance for us, the excellence of Jacob, whom he loves, Selah. God has gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet. Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing praises with understanding. God reigns over the nations. God sits on his holy throne. The princes of the people have gathered together, the people of the God of Abraham, for the shields of the earth belong to God. He is greatly exalted. So we're going to sing that together. He is exalted. The King is exalted on high.
Yeah.
Father, we are grateful today for your goodness to us. And God, we want to bless your name this morning. We want to lift up your name because you indeed are worthy. You are the exalted one, the creator of all things, the master, the ruler of all. And we are your servants, and we want to praise you and thank you this morning for your goodness to us. So we ask that the songs we sing and the words that we speak, Lord, would be a sweet-smelling savor to you today. And we ask, God, that through it, Lord, that you would be exalted and our hearts would be lifted up. Our hearts would be lifted to you, and we just ask, God, that you'll just minister to us as only you can. So as we continue, we ask, God, that you'll accept these our words of thanksgiving and praise.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, the old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction.
Truth today, will you one day exchange your cross for a crown. Jesus did that for us. And in Christ alone is where our hope is found, isn't it? In Jesus alone, we have hope. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has begotten us into a living hope, it says, by the resurrection from the dead.
Good morning. We're going to do some announcements now, so if you take out your bulletin, we're going to go through it line by line. So first up is February 19th, that's today. Sunday morning coffee was at 10, if you missed it, that's sorry. Colin says it was very good, just to inform you. The only one I will take note of there on today is Junior Church, or is Tina, so if you don't have a lesson prepared, you probably should get one pretty quick. Moving on to this week, Sunday evening, we're just going to have the walking club and the recreational activities today. Midweek, not going to go into too much there. You guys can read all those. It's all the normal stuff going on. We are going skating Saturday. My wife got an alert on her phone, something about some storm at the end of the week. It's supposed to be the worst storm of the season, so it probably shouldn't be too bad. But just be praying that we can actually do it, because it's the one thing we've planned, and of course that would be the one where we'd get a storm on. So be praying for that, because it's going to be a really good time. And like Colin said last week, anybody can come. If you don't want to skate, just come. It'd be great fellowship. Grab some Tim Hortons on your way so you'll be warm. Upcoming dates, ladies' breakfast. It says details to come. The details are here right now. It's the 18th. That's the details. We will have a sign-up sheet later on, I'm assuming, when it gets closer. Colin, yes? Sign-up sheet, breakfast, when it gets closer, yeah. Kids Quest Camp Night, they're looking forward to that. I would be looking forward to that. Sounds pretty cool. That's on March 2nd. Easter Choir is going to start up. I think it's next week. Yep, this Sunday coming. That'd be a week from today. Easter Choir, it says open to all singers, teens to seniors. So that's a lot of us, so we probably all should go. Yeah, I won't be there. I think that's all I have other than one more. And Kathy says if I get this wrong, she's just going to stand up and take over. Okay? So we're going to see how this goes. 55 plus, there's supposed to be a storm on Thursday. Okay? So Kathy wants to see a show of hands. Who would rather see it on Sunday? Is that right, Kathy?
Well, it's canceled.
If it's canceled on Thursday, who would come on Sunday? So if it's canceled on Thursday, would you come on Sunday? Hands raised.
That's for
seniors. Yeah. That's for 55 plus. Yeah. Okay. Kathy, you got that?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, so if you could send Kathy a message, if you're someone 55 plus that normally couldn't go through the week, who would like to go on Sunday, make sure you let her know so that she can account for that.
And I'll let you know if it is canceled.
Yes, and she'll let you know beforehand on Thursday if it's canceled. Is that clear? Clear as mud. I'm seeing some heads nod, so I think we're good, Kathy. And I think that's all we have for announcements.
Okay, thank you, Blair, for clearing everything up for us.
Everybody's more confused now than ever before.
I like the statement sometimes, there's supposed to be a storm on Thursday. I don't know about that one. It's forecasted that perhaps there might be a snow event on Thursday.
Thursday through Sunday.
Yeah. Thursday through Sunday. Well, there we go. We heard it. Okay. Before Colin comes, I just want to remind us of a couple things. The scripture tells us to bear one another's burdens. And at our Wednesday night Bible study time, we usually ask people if they have people that they want to pray for and have prayed for. And we do that on a weekly basis. And I think that's an important thing. Important part of our ministry is to always remember those who are sick, those who need encouragement, those who have some burdens that they need some help with. And so I think that's important to remember that as a body, as a church family, to bear one another's burdens. And so we encourage you to do that. If you see someone who has a need, or invite someone over, share a coffee and a piece of pie too. Don't forget the pie, and encourage and help one another. Before Colin comes, we'll pray together and ask the blessing. Father, we just thank you so much today, Lord, for our time together. We thank you that we can freely come to this place. We can come, we can worship, and we can hear the word of God spoken. We just ask, God, as our children go downstairs, that, God, you would just empower the teachers, Lord, to present the Word of God in such a way that their young minds would understand it, comprehend it, and, Lord, absorb it into their lives. So we just ask, God, your blessing on that program and for Pastor Colin as he comes. We just ask, God, that you'll just give him the words to speak. We ask, God, that the Spirit of God would take the Word of God and apply it to each of our lives. And we pray, Lord, for one another here today, Lord, that you would indeed bear our burdens, and Lord, help us, Lord, to also be burden bearers for our brothers and sisters around us. So we ask your blessing as we continue. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, everybody. Normally, I say that way earlier in the service. I really appreciate the crew giving me a bit of a week off. For those of you who don't know, we're getting down to crunch time for our little boy to come, so I've been taking a little bit of extra time to be at home and helping out, so I really appreciate you guys stepping up, Jeff. Well, if you have your Bibles this morning, you can turn to Genesis chapter 15, and we are excited to continue on in our series. It's been a little bit since we've been together, but we are certainly thankful for this time. We're thankful for the last couple of weeks having Corey Vail here, who taught us what the gospel truly was and clearly laid that out, and we are so excited about that. And then obviously last week having Ed Seeley here was a huge encouragement, and glad that we could take some time to minister with some other folks. But here we are, back to our series that we are calling Following in Faith, studying the story of Abram, who will eventually become Abraham. So just by way of recap, in case you're maybe joining us for the first time this morning, or perhaps you've just forgot over the past 2 weeks, I forget things all the time. As we've been going through this series, so far we've established one key fact about the story of Abram. And the story of Abram, who would later become Abraham, is the key turning point in biblical history when God begins to enact his plan of redemption, as promised to Adam and Eve back in Genesis 3:15. We remember that God created mankind for fellowship and unity and relationship, but Adam and Eve chose to rebel against God and to seek after the authority for themselves, and they ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and because of that, the curse of sin was introduced. The curse of sin, which brings death and separation from God, but also which brings corruption to this world. But God promised in Genesis 3:15 that he would send someone called the seed of the woman, who in Jewish history they would come to call the Messiah. This one who was promised, who would come and not only rescue mankind from the curse of sin, but put an end to the curse of sin by bringing salvation. And when we see the story of Abram's life, as we follow his journey of faith, we see it as the beginning point of God enacting this plan, because he would take Abram from this place called the Ur of the Chaldeans, and he would bring him to the land of Canaan, and God would make four promises to Abram. We've discussed these promises. First, he says, Abram, I'm going to make a great nation from you. Keep in mind, Abram is very old. He and his wife are well into their twilight years, and yet God says, I'm going to not only give you a child, but I'm going to make of you a nation, and this would be the nation of Israel. He then promises Abram's descendants would have the land, and we're actually going to get into that a little bit more this morning, because when we come to Genesis 15, we finally see the borders of that land laid out. Third, God says that he would bless Abram, and this is the promise to not only protect, but to defend and uphold the nation of Israel. And then finally, in the most important promise, God promises that through Abram, the entire world would be blessed. And this, obviously, we know here, as hindsight is 2020, we know that to be the promise of the Messiah, because Jesus would ultimately come through the line and the family of Abram. And so last time we were together in Genesis 14, we read the account of what we decided to call the Battle of the Nine Kings, right? We had these four Mesopotamian overlords that came into the region of Canaan and waged war against five smaller city-states, and in doing so, laid waste and kidnapped and took captives away. And in the process, Abram's nephew Lot, who was living in the land of Sodom, was taken captive. So Abram and 300 of his closest buddies got together, and they go after these kings. And not only do they defeat them, but they defeat them to the extent that they are able to free the captives and bring them back to the land of Canaan. And when we left off last week, Abram was returning to the land of Hebron where he was living. And on the way, he is met by two individuals. There was Bera, the king of Sodom, and Melchizedek, the king of Salem. And we discussed that Sodom represents the enticement of the world, the allure of sin, the things that sin promises us that seem attractive and yet will ultimately bring destruction. And the king of Sodom offered Abram all of the riches, all of the spoils from that skirmish. He said, just give me the people and you can take everything else. You can have the wealth associated with this victory. You can have the fame associated with this victory. And yet Abram rejected the king of Sodom. We saw that he rejected the king of Sodom because, first and foremost, he wanted to bring glory to God. He wanted God to receive the credit for what took place. And he didn't want Sodom to receive any credit for making Abram a great nation. He said, God has promised to make me a great nation. God has promised to increase me. So I'm not going to allow the world to do what God has clearly promised. And then we see his interaction with the king of Salem, Melchizedek, who we discussed is a type of Christ, in that he is a picture, a foreshadowing of some of the roles that Jesus himself would fulfill, that being the king and also the priest of the Most High God, the one who would make intercession. And we saw that Melchizedek offered Abram blessing. He didn't offer him riches. He didn't offer him anything more than refreshment and blessing. He said, all the glory is going to go to God, Abram, and I'm blessing you because God has caused this to happen. And we see that Abram shares in fellowship with Melchizedek, recognizing that the glory should ultimately go to God. And it's from this moment that we left off in our last study at the end of Genesis 14, when Abram chooses fealty to God over the fame of the world, that we come to what is probably going to be one of the most important passages in our study. So buckle up. I'm going to try to get through this. We're going to get through the whole chapter this morning. But as we study through these verses this morning, we're going to see one of the most important chapters in the account of Abram's life. And without a doubt, one of the most important verses in the whole of Scripture. As we get to, I won't spoil it, but I'll spoil a little bit, Genesis 15:6. We'll be looking forward to breaking that down a little bit. So before we dive in, let's just ask God to lead us this morning. Father, as we have prayed, we are so thankful to have this opportunity to look into your word. God, we thank you for the ministry of this church. We ask that you would cause us to seek your glory above all else, that we would seek the furtherance of the gospel, that we would see this community and the surrounding communities come to a saving knowledge of you. God, but it all starts with faith. It all starts with us following in faith and obeying you. And God, so as we read this morning, we ask that you would speak to our hearts, that you would give us a greater sense of your character, of your grace, of your love, but also of your justice, God, and your righteousness. And we ask that you would speak to our hearts this morning and that we would be receptive and open to receive your teaching. And we ask all of these things in Christ's name. Amen. So, Genesis chapter 15, we're going to break this down this morning into just two sections. Two sections. I think we can get through two sections this morning. The first section that we're going to read is verses 1 through 6, where we see the Lord coming and he speaks to Abram. He initiates this conversation. And as we're going to dig into this a little bit, we're going to see that conversation progress into something incredibly significant in the history of Israel and in the history and in the account of Abram's story. But let's just go ahead and begin by reading verses 1 through 6. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Fear not, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward will be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, Behold, you have given me no offspring, so a member of my household will be my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. Your very own son shall be your heir. And he brought him outside and said, Look toward the heavens and number the stars if you're able to number them. Then he said to him, So shall your offspring be. And Abram believed the Lord, and he counted it to him as righteousness. So as we're reading these verses, the first thing that we see, obviously, is that after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. So immediately following Abram's defeat of the Mesopotamian kings, immediately after Abram's rejection of Sodom and acceptance of Salem, God appears to Abram. Now, throughout Abram's life, and we talked about this in our last study together, God would periodically come and he would speak to Abram. He takes different forms. Sometimes he speaks directly. In this case, it's a vision. We're going to see in a few chapters that God is actually going to send a physical messenger to come and speak to Abram. But here, after everything that Abram has immediately been through, God appears and begins to speak to him. And God immediately initiates this conversation with promise and with comfort. Because of Abram's faithfulness in the previous chapter, he makes three statements. And I think the first is really indicative of, you know, I'll just read it for you. It simply says, fear not. God comes to Abram, and the first thing he says is, fear not. Now, back at Christmas, we discussed that this term, fear not, is in the Bible a whole lot of times. Because it's this constant reoccurring theme that when God would interact with his people, there would be a sense of fear and trembling. So he would try to put them at ease first before he would tell them what he was going to tell them. But in this case, it's not so much God saying, Abram, don't be afraid of me, because we understand Abram's relationship with God at this point. Abram, though he made mistakes, and he's going to continue to make some mistakes, next week we're going to get into a pretty hairy one. But even in the midst of Abram's mistakes, he has a trust in God. So when God appears, he's not saying, Abram, don't be afraid of me. He's speaking to what's going on in Abram's heart. He says, fear not. Fear not. And just to remind us of the context, this is happening directly after Abram, with three guys, goes on a little road trip up north and conquers four major Mesopotamian cities in the night. So you have to picture potentially, and again, we can only read what's here in the text, but I don't have a doubt in my mind, because Abram was a man, he was a human being, he was flawed. I guarantee you that after all of this had happened, Abram's probably thinking to himself, okay, so I pulled this off with 300 guys. That's awesome. What happens when these kings retaliate? What happens when potentially these nations that I have just ticked off decide to come back down with greater force and teach me a lesson? Because when you look at it on paper, it makes absolutely no sense that this one guy, Abram, and 300 hired mercenaries could accomplish what five city-states could not in conquering these major kings. And yet, because God was with him, as Melchizedek said, God delivered these kings into Abram's hand. But Abram's still a man, so he's probably concerned to an extent what happens when they come back. I don't think me and 300 guys can handle a retaliation. But God says, fear not. This greeting immediately speaks to the struggle that Abram is dealing with in his heart, and it's a reminder for us that God always knows what's going on in our heart, and we're going to get into that in just a minute. There is nothing that we struggle with that God is not intimately knowledgeable about. God knows what Abram's struggling with, so he comes, and the first thing he says is, Abram, fear not. But then he gives him a reason not to fear. He says, Abram, don't fear, and here's why. I am your shield. Think about that. Think about how comforting and reassuring that must be for Abram when the almighty creator of the universe says, Abram, I've got your back. Don't be afraid. I am your shield. And this is a promise that God not only makes to Abram, but it's a promise that we read throughout Scripture. That God is the shield for those who would seek refuge in him. And there is just this incredible promise that Abram receives here. And it certainly echoes what Melchizedek said to Abram back in Genesis 14, verse 20. When Melchizedek comes out of Salem, he provides a meal for Abram and his soldiers. And then he says this, blessed be Abram by God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth. I love that, how Melchizedek refers to God as the possessor, not just the creator, but the possessor of heaven and earth. And then Melchizedek says this, "And blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hand." Nothing that Abram accomplishes does he accomplish on his own. As we've read before, whenever Abram tries to take matters into his own hands and not listen to God, things go south very, very quickly. But when we see Abram trusting God and following in faith, we see success. And we see these beautiful things take place. So God says, "Abram, fear not, I am your shield." And then finally he says, "Your reward shall be very great." Your reward shall be very great. And again, I'm going to keep drawing us back here to Genesis 14 because we have to keep in mind this passage begins with after these things, so we have to know what these things were. What did Abram just do? He just rejected riches and wealth and fame and the spoils of war that the king of Sodom was offering him. Abram said, "I'm not going to take a single sandal strap from you because I want the honor and the glory to be to God and to God alone." So not only did Abram not take the spoils for himself, but we actually see that before he gives everything back to Sodom, he actually takes a tenth of everything and gives it to Melchizedek as an act of worship towards God. Because Melchizedek was concerned with God receiving the glory, so Abram says, "I recognize that, I agree with that, I'm going to honor that by giving you a tenth of the spoils, and then I'm not going to take a single bit for myself. I'm going to give it back because I do not want to receive riches and wealth and fame from the world." So this statement from God, "Your reward shall be very great," is this beautiful affirmation, right? You see where I'm going with this? It's this affirmation of, "Abram, you did the right thing. Seeking my glory first and foremost was the right response. So because of that, your reward shall be very great." And these are some amazing promises. This is an incredible way to start a conversation. Imagine God appearing to you and saying, "I've got your back, I will be your shield, and I will look after your needs." Isn't that an incredible thing? This must have been an incredible moment for Abram. But in the next verses 2 and 3, what we're going to see here is the intimacy and the transparency and the flat-out honesty that Abram is able to have with God. Because immediately after receiving these incredible promises and these words of encouragement, Abram immediately does what? He expresses concern. He says, "God, I'm not super comfortable with how things are playing out here." Beginning in verse 2, "But Abram said, O Lord God." I'm going to stop there. Because what Abram's about to do is he's about to express some concerns that are on his heart. But the first thing he does is he recognizes God's authority. He says, "O Lord God." God. These two words are Adonai Elohim. O Master and my God. Abram doesn't just come out and say, "God, here are the issues that I have." He recognizes with humility who God is first and foremost. He says, "O Lord God." And then he says, "What will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus." And Abram said, "Behold, you have given me no offspring, so a member of my household will be my heir." Now, I say this very often as we're studying these things. We have to remember that this was not written in English. The English comes across, well, pretty curt. It comes across pretty blatant and straightforward. "God, you promised me a kid, and I don't have a kid, so I guess I'm going with Eliezer." But the reality is in the Hebrew, there's much more significance to what is being said. When Abram says, "What will you give me, for I continue childless," this phrase, "for I continue," in the Hebrew, it literally says, "God, I'm going to die before I have a kid." Because Abram is recognizing his age, and he's recognizing the fact that he doesn't see his own capabilities to produce an heir. He looks to God and he says, "And the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus." Now, this is the only mention we have of Eliezer. We don't know anything of him other than what is said right here, and that is his name is Eliezer. He's from Damascus. And in verse 3, we see that he is a servant of Abram. Okay? Now, we need to just kind of take a step back, and we need to do a little bit of a mini recap on Abram's story, right? Beginning all the way back in Genesis chapter 11, we see Abram's family tree. And he had a brother named Haran, and his brother Haran had a son named Lot. And Lot's father, Haran, died. So Abram takes Lot under his wing. Now remember, Abram, his name means exalted father. So in many ways, Abram takes Lot under his wing and likely, culturally, assumes that Lot is now going to be his heir. God promises him a nation. So Abram's initial solution is, okay, well, I have Lot with me. That's why Abram takes Lot with him wherever they go. But then what does Lot do? He forsakes Abram and he moves to Sodom. So now Abram's saying, okay, so it wasn't Lot. Perhaps it's Eliezer. Perhaps it is this young man that I have with me. So Abram says, God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer. Behold, you have given me no offspring, so a member of my household will be my heir. Now, what I want us to see here is that Abram is honest with God about the things that he's struggling with. He is honest with God about his concerns, about his fear, about his uncertainty. As we discussed just a few minutes ago, when God comes in and says, fear not, I am your shield and your reward will be very great, Abram doesn't have any part of that conversation. God starts and he immediately speaks to what Abram already has going on in his heart. So Abram knows that he can just be honest. He knows that he can speak clearly with God. He speaks from his heart, but as we said, not before he humbly acknowledges God's authority and position when he says, oh, Lord God. And here's what I want us to see this morning from these verses, is that this transparency that Abram has before God is an incredibly beautiful and wonderful picture of what our prayer life should look like, right? See, Abram comes before God in humility, but he doesn't hold back his frustrations. He doesn't hold back his concerns. He doesn't hold back his I guess we could say doubt, but we'll get into that word in a minute. He clearly tells God what is going on in his heart because he understands that God already knows what's going on in his heart. So instead of holding in his frustration, he brings it before God with an honest approach. And Peter teaches us this idea in his first letter to the church. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 6 and 7, Peter says this, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that in the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him. Why? Because he cares for you. See, Abram's dealing with a significant amount of anxiety right now. He's up there in years. He recognizes that God has given him a promise. He's faithfully followed this promise, but he's not seeing too much fulfillment yet. Plus, he's just come through this likely very traumatic experience of going and rescuing Lot. And now he's standing before God, and he finally just breaks down. He says, God, I don't understand what's going on. I don't understand why these things haven't happened yet. You're saying that you're going to fulfill these promises, and yet I don't have a child. I'm here with Eliezer. What are we actually doing here? And on the surface, it seems that Abram is showing doubt. It would seem that he is doubting God. And this is where I kind of want to go on like a little just mini rabbit trail, and I want to say something. And that is that the church, big C, generalized, okay, throughout history, historically, the church has not done a great job with this issue of doubt, okay? We have not done a great job at speaking to those who express doubts and questions. We wonder why so many young people leave the church. Well, first and foremost, the reality of the fact is it's a lack of fruitful relationship with God, but the second reason many of them use is I had questions and the church wouldn't answer them, or the older folks wouldn't answer them. We tend to shut down the hard questions and discourage those who express doubt rather than graciously guiding them through Scripture. And here's the deal. If somebody's going to express doubts and you give them Scripture, not our opinions, but the Word of God, if they're at that point going to continue to express doubt and have issues, well, then that's on them. You've done what you can, right? But what we need to understand this morning is that there are two types of doubt. One of them very much is sin, but the other is just basic humanity. Because there's two types of doubt. There is a doubt that denies God's goodness. There is a doubt that denies God's promise. It's a doubt that says, I don't believe God exists, I don't think God exists, and I'm going to seek to tear everything down in order to prove that God is not real, that God is not loving, that God is not in control. That's a doubt that denies God, and that is sin. As we read in Scripture, it is the fool that says in his heart there is no God. But then there's a doubt that doesn't deny God's word, but there's a doubt that desires God's goodness. There's a doubt that has questions because they want to have deeper faith, because they want to understand more significantly what is going on. So what Abram is not doing here is he's not saying, God, I don't trust you anymore because these things haven't happened that you said have happened. That couldn't be further from what's going on. Abram is seeking after simple clarification. He's simply asking God, as any child in the back seat would ask, are we there yet? Are we there yet? See, the kid in the back who asks, are we there yet, doesn't deny the fact that the parent knows where they're going. They just want to know if they're there yet. And that's why I say there's two types of doubt. There's a doubt that denies God's goodness, but then there's a doubt that desires it. And Abram simply wanted to trust, and he was looking for God to strengthen his faith. He's saying, God, I know that you've promised this, but I don't understand what's going on. Help me to understand this better. And God's response to Abram is nothing short of absolutely wonderful and beautiful, because in verses 4 and 5, God simply offers promise. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, this man shall not be your heir, referring to Eliezer, but your very own son shall be your heir. God is saying, Abram, don't worry about Lot. Don't worry about Eliezer. You are going to have a child. Your son is going to be your heir. And then God does this incredibly beautiful thing. He takes Abram outside and he says, look toward the heaven. Number the stars, if you're able to number them. And then he said, so shall your offspring be. And this is where we come to what is probably one of the most important verses in all of Scripture, Genesis 15:6, which simply says, and Abram believed the Lord, and he counted it to him as righteousness. You see, this verse, Genesis 15:6, is the foundation for our understanding of the doctrine of justification. It's this understanding that God's plan for humanity has always been faith, and faith alone. You see, Abram's only reason for believing any of these promises are going to come to pass is that God said they were. The only assurance he has at this point to rely on is God's word. And what's so incredible is that for Abram, that's enough. God's promise is enough, and Abram shows active trust in God, and in response, God regards him as righteous. Abram believed the Lord, and the Lord accounted it to him as righteousness. And the New Testament writers quote this verse over and over and over again to show us that this idea of justification and redemption has always been by faith, not by works. See, God's expectation for humanity has always been faith. We aren't saved because of what we do. We are justified by our faith, just as Abram was. And as we read in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10, it is by grace that we're saved through what? Faith. Right? But then we have to include verse 10 because we have been created for what? Good works. Our good deeds do not save us, but they are a manifestation of our faith, right? So Abram believes God, and God accounts him as righteous. But of course, Abram's belief is an active belief. It's a belief that puts chips on the table, that gets involved. And that's where we come to the next 13 verses, which I promise we will go through much faster than the previous six. And then God said to Abram, I am the Lord who brought you out of the Ur, the Chaldeans, to give you this land to possess. So now God makes this covenant promise that we call the Abrahamic covenant or the land covenant. And God once again reiterates and affirms his promise to Abram, this land that he has made for his descendants. He says, I am the Lord. I am God. I am in charge. And I brought you out of the Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. And Abram, again, being honest and transparent with God, even though he believes in the promise, he still has concerns. So what does he say? He says, oh, Lord God, how am I to know that I shall possess it? And then the Lord does this seemingly strange thing, and he tells Abram to bring in a series of animals. He says, bring me a heifer 3 years old, a female goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. And he brought him all these things, cut them in half, and laid each half over against the other, but he did not cut the birds in half. And when the birds of prey came down on the carcasses, Abram drove them away. Seems a little weird. Let me shed some light on this to help us understand. This was actually a cultural practice. This was a legally binding ceremony that was referred to as cutting a covenant. We say cutting a covenant because you would take these series of animals. In this case, there was a cow, a goat, a ram, and two birds. And the animals would be split in half, okay? And they would put one half on either side of this little stretch of land, only a few feet apart. And in these times, in the times of the patriarchs, the process of cutting a covenant involved two parties making an agreement and then together walking through the animals. It was their way of saying, we are going into this contract as equals, and we are both recognizing that should either one of us fail to uphold our part of the contract, well, let us be like the animals. This was a binding ceremony where two men would bind themselves to one another to accomplish something. And they would say, and one of them would simply say, if I don't hold up my end, let me be as one of these animals. What did we say when we were kids? Cross my heart and hope to die. Same idea, right? This was a legally binding ceremony. So Abram, as he's being honest and transparent with God, he's simply saying, God, are we there yet? I need something to work with here because I'm struggling with seeing what's going on. And God says, I'll do you one better. We're going to cut a covenant. We are going to have a legally binding covenant to show that I am going to fulfill my promise. But as soon as Abram gets everything ready, we come to verse 12, and it says this. And as the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell on Abram. And behold, a dreadful and great darkness fell upon him. And then the Lord said to Abraham, know for certain that your offspring will be sojourners in a land that is not theirs, and will be servants there, and they will be afflicted for 400 years. But I will bring judgment on the nation that they serve, and afterward they shall come out with great possession. And as you go, you shall go to your fathers in peace, and you shall be buried in a good old age. And they shall come back here in the fourth generation, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete. So as soon as Abram makes the preparations for this cultural process, this contract ceremony, God causes him to fall asleep. We're going to circle back because there's a significance there. But as he is sleeping, God prophesies to Abram of the struggle of the nation of Israel in the land of Egypt and promises the Exodus story. When we read Exodus, we read exactly what is happening here. The nation of Israel was in Egypt because of famine, but they stayed there too long, and because of it, they became enslaved by the nation of Egypt for over 400 years. And then what does God do? He sends this guy named Mo. There it is. There's a smile. He sends this guy named Moses to go in and say to Pharaoh, "Let my people go." And when Pharaoh says no, God judges the nation of Egypt, and he rescues the nation of Israel through the Exodus, and then they come back to the land. The beautiful thing to see here is that God tells Abram what's going to happen to his descendants, and what he's saying is, Abram, I am promising you this land for your descendants. You're not going to get the whole thing, and they're not even going to get the whole thing for a while because they're going to have to struggle with sin issues just like you did. But you, Abram, I promise you, you're going to live to a ripe old age, and you're going to die peacefully and be gathered to your people. He says, Abram, you may not see the immediate fulfillment of this promise, but I'm still going to fulfill it. And we may ask ourselves, why does it need to be 400 years? Why does there need to be this stretch of time? Well, we see here in verse 16, it's because God says, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete. And this verse is an incredible picture of God's patience and grace and mercy, and it's a verse that way too many people ignore. When we come to the book of Joshua, after Moses has died, as the nation of Israel is coming back into the land of Canaan, one of the biggest points of contention for non-believers and people who are in the process of doubting faith is, why on earth would a loving and holy God tell the nation of Israel to go into the land of Canaan and wipe out every last man, woman, and child and drive out these nations? That doesn't seem very loving. That's genocidal. That's ridiculous. And if you only read the book of Joshua on the surface, it can almost kind of seem that way, but you have to look at scripture within the whole context of what's going on. And here, 800 years before Joshua and the nation of Israel would enter into the land of Canaan, God is saying to Abram, I am giving these people 800 more years than they've already had to turn back from me, or to turn back to me. To turn away from idolatry, to turn away from immorality, to turn away from child sacrifice, to turn away from gross wickedness. God is saying to Abram, I'm giving them 800 years from this point, but even before that, they still had several centuries. Keep in mind, the world was populated by one family, Noah, who worshiped God. And he had three sons who worshiped God. When we look at the nations within the region of Canaan, we know because we see a king like Melchizedek who worshiped God. They had centuries to turn back to the God that they knew was real. And this is just a quick little picture of God's grace and fulfillment, but also a reminder that sin will always have a day of reckoning. So God says to Abram, look, you're not going to receive the promise just yet. Your descendants aren't going to receive it just yet, but they will eventually. But I'm giving time for the Amorites to repent. And that's what you need to understand. Because Abram's saying, God, are we there yet? And God's saying, we're not there yet, and here's why. Because there are thousands and thousands and thousands of people who need an opportunity to come back to me. See, often we wonder, why hasn't Christ returned yet? Because Christ has left us with a job. And there are millions and millions and millions of lost souls going to hell today, and God is giving them an opportunity to repent and to turn to him. Today is the day of salvation. But let's get back to this. We come to verse 17, and here is where we see why God had caused Abram to fall asleep. It says, and when the sun had gone down and it was dark, behold, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passed between these pieces. And on that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying to your offspring, I give this land from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates, from the land of the Kenites and the Kenizzites and the Kadmonites and the Hittites and the Perizzites and the Rephaim, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Girgashites, and the Jebusites. A lot of sites. See, in these next verses, we see God making this covenant, what we call the Abrahamic covenant, which is a combination of the promises that he made in Genesis chapter 12, and then this fleshing out here. Now, really quick, there are two types of covenants in Scripture, okay? There are conditional covenants, and there are unconditional covenants. Conditional covenants require mankind to hold up some sort of end of the bargain. They require action on man's part to see the promises of God fulfilled. For example, the Mosaic Covenant, which was the giving of the law. In the Mosaic Covenant, the children of Israel had to follow the law and they had to stay faithful to God if they were to expect God's protection, provision, and their place in the land. Whenever they failed to do so, they would open themselves up to invasion, to oppression, and to all sorts of terrible things. And if you don't believe me, read the book of Judges, you'll get a chapter and a half in, and you'll see this pattern start. They do whatever they want, the whole thing falls apart, but when they come back to God, he protects them. So that's the Mosaic covenant, that's a conditional covenant. But then there's unconditional covenants, such as the Noahic covenant, which we read about back in Genesis chapter 9 through 11, where God, after flooding the earth, makes a covenant with Noah that he will not flood the whole earth at once ever again. And as a sign of this covenant, God gives us the rainbow so that when we see it, we can remember God's promise to not flood the whole earth. That is an unconditional covenant. There's no if clause. There's no point in that covenant where God is going to change his mind because of something we've done. In fact, we read in Scripture that when God comes back to ultimately destroy the earth and to rescue the remnant and to rescue believers and to recreate a new heaven and a new earth, he's not going to destroy the world with water. Instead, he's going to destroy it with fire because he made an unconditional covenant not to flood the whole earth ever again. So verse 17 shows us the reason that God caused Abram to fall asleep, because he was about to make an unconditional covenant. Because we see that when the sun went down, as Abram is laying over there incapacitated, God himself walks alone through the pieces of the covenant. He doesn't invite Abram to walk through, because remember, culturally, when you cut a covenant, you would have two parties go through. They would go through as equals, and they would recognize that the onus was on both of them to fulfill this contract. But God says, no, Abram, sit down. This is on me. He walks through alone. See, God caused Abram to sleep so that Abram wouldn't walk through with God. This covenant promise that God made to Abram was unconditional, 100% dependent on God, and didn't rely on Abram doing anything, because God in his infinite goodness was unilaterally signing this contract, saying, Abram, this isn't on you, this is on me. And in doing so, he's saying that its fulfillment relied fully on his character and his goodness. So we know that this covenant would not and will not fail, because God cannot fail. That's the promise that God was making to Abram. He's saying, I'm putting the complete onus of this on me, because I cannot and will not fail. And just really quick before we close, I'll make a note of this. It says that when it went dark, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passed through these pieces. And these are the two symbols that God uses to represent himself walking through. And both of these elements actually foreshadow God's relationship with the children of Israel. Because when you read the books of Exodus through Deuteronomy, as God leads the children of Israel out of Egypt, during the day, he leads the nation as what? A cloud of smoke. And at night, as what? A pillar of fire. So as God walks through the covenant now as a smoking fire pot and as a burning torch. He's foreshadowing his protection and his direction and his leadership of the nation of Israel. So as we read this passage this morning, we see the goodness of God and the fact that God is always going to keep his word, even in spite of Abram's uncertainty. In fact, we actually read later in the Old Testament, we see God fulfill these border parameters. I wasn't going to do another map because I'm not good with maps. But God actually fulfills for a short period of time these exact border parameters in 1 Kings chapter 4, verse 21. It's during the reign of King Solomon when the nation was at its largest. And we understand that this was a picture of God's goodness and reliability. But the most important thing that I want us to note in this passage and what I want us to walk away with this morning is the simple fact. You can trust God this morning. You may be asking, are we there yet? You can trust God this morning. You may be wondering why you don't have the status or the things that you want in life. You can trust God to provide for your needs and not for your wants. When Abram expressed concern and doubt, God didn't shut him down, didn't call him faithless, didn't cast him out. Instead, God reminded Abram of who he was. He said, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the Ur of Chaldees. And I am making this covenant with you. And Abram responded in faith. But like Abram's situation, often the circumstances of life tempt us to have doubts and concerns. We struggle with relationships, with work, with anxiety, the weight of sin on our conscience, and so often we find ourselves completely and utterly overwhelmed. But as we read in 1 Peter chapter 5, it is in those moments that we can cast our cares on God. We can come to him knowing that he is good, that he is trustworthy. And it's not because of anything we do. The theologian Jonathan Edwards famously said, you contribute nothing to your salvation but the sin that made it necessary. And that's the reality this morning. Is that in spite of us, God is constant, God is unchanging, and he can be trusted whatever comes our way. And we can trust him because of the unconditional promise of redemption in the person of Jesus Christ. And lastly, I just want to leave us with this thought this morning. The Abrahamic covenant shows us that we can and should always expect God's promises to be fulfilled. Because God is a God of promises. God is a God of fulfillment. We need to recognize that he is completely free to choose how and will he will fulfill those promises. And we need to be okay with that. That everything is in his timing. Everything is in his agenda and his control. But as we wait, just like Abram, we live by faith. And we just keep trusting God and following him. I'll invite the team up and we'll pray. Father, this morning, help us, like Abram, to recognize your love. Help us to recognize your authority and your control. And God, most importantly, help us to recognize that we can trust you with our lives. Father, we love you because you loved us first. Help us to recognize this and help us to actively live out our faith this week. Give us opportunity to share the gospel. Give us opportunity to point people to you. And God, cause us to be responsible to follow through on those opportunities. We love you and we praise you and we ask that you would bless us now in Christ's name. Amen.
Reinforce the what we've just heard. We're just going to sing this little chorus. I just keep trusting my Lord. So we can just stand together and we'll sing this as we close. I just
I can count on him to the very end. Though the storm clouds darken the sky or the heavenly tread, I just keep trusting my Lord, he will never fail.
Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen.